Simon & Schuster Audio presents State of the Union by Brad Thor, read by George Guidall and directed by Abigail McHugh.
Washington, D.C., Tuesday evening, January 28th. "What I want, Chuck, is 10 minutes of peace and quiet so I can think," snapped the president to his chief of staff. Charles Anderson had never seen his boss like this. Then again, America had never faced a situation of this magnitude before. With less than 3 hours until he was expected to deliver his State of the Union address, President Jack Rutledge had already made the tough decision of evacuating Congress and settling on a videotaped address from the White House. The hardest call, though, still lay before him.
"Okay, people," voiced Anderson. "You heard the president. Let's give him the room. Everybody out. We'll reconvene in the Situation Room."
Once the Oval Office had cleared out, the president leaned back in his chair, closed his eyes, and massaged his forehead with the heels of his hands. His oath of office called for him to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution, a body of laws which obliged him to give to Congress information of the State of the Union and recommend to their consideration such measures as he shall judge necessary and expedient. Never in a million years could he have imagined that the execution of his duties would lead to the unraveling of everything America had fought to become. How in the hell had things come to this? Rutledge wondered as he opened his eyes and studied the two folders on the desk in front of him. Each contained a different version of his State of the Union address, and each had the potential to be equally devastating. The fate of millions of Americans would be decided by what he said and did in the next 3 hours. Though not a particularly religious man, President Jack Rutledge closed his eyes once again and this time prayed to God for guidance. Zvenigorod, Russia, 3 weeks prior.
"Winter has come too early this year," complained Sergei Stavropol, as he threw his long overcoat onto a chair near the door.
He was the last of the four men to arrive. Crossing over to the bar, he withdrew a decanter of brandy and filled a delicate crystal snifter. He was an enormous man with dark hair and a large nose that bore evidence of having been broken many times. At 6'3" tall and 275 pounds, he was bigger than any of the others, but it was his dark, penetrating eyes that drew all of the attention and that had long ago earned him his nickname, Rasputin. His salt-and-pepper-colored hair was trimmed in a military-style crew-cut. His skin was severely pockmarked, and his left eye drooped slightly due to a grenade that had exploded in his face as he was pushing one of his men out of danger's way. While he was twice as brave as his assembled colleagues, he was easily less than half as refined, and as if to demonstrate that very fact, he downed his brandy in one long swallow. The men around the table smiled at their friend's behavior. Stavropol was as constant as the Northern Star. In over 40 years, nothing had changed him. Not money, not power, not even the knowledge that he would go down in history as one of the greatest soldiers Mother Russia had ever produced. In combat, he had saved the life of each man in the room, some more than once. But they had not gathered at this remote hunting lodge 40 miles west of Moscow to relive the past. Stavropol, the group's leader, walked over to the fireplace, raised himself to his full height, turned to his colleagues and said,
"It pleases me to see you all here. We have waited many long years for this. Today we embark upon a new and glorious chapter in the history of not only our beloved Russia, but of the world. 15 years ago we were much younger,"
interrupted one of the men. It was Valentin Primovich, the plotter, the warrior. He had always been the weakest link. Stavropol fixed him with a steady look.
"Valentin, we are still young men."
"And we have good lives now,"
said Uri Varensky, coming to the defense of Primovich.
"The world is a different place. Russia is a different place."
"As we knew it would be," said Stavropol as his eyes turned on Varensky.
He had grown soft and lazy.
"You forget that the change came because of us. It was our idea."
"It was your idea,"
replied Anatoly Karganov. We supported you as we always have. But Uri and Valentin are correct. Times have changed. Stavropol couldn't believe his ears. Was Karganov, one of the greatest military minds the country had ever seen, siding with Primovich and Varensky? The Anatoly Karganov?
Despite all of his careful planning, the meeting was not going the way Stavropol had envisioned. He stopped and took a deep breath before continuing.
I have seen these changes. The Soviet Union was once a great empire covering 11 time zones, but look at us now. Most of our sister republics are gone, and we are locked in pitiable struggles to hold on to those few that remain. Our economy, the free market economy so widely embraced by our greedy countrymen, teeters daily on the verge of collapse. Where once we were a great world power, a superpower, now we are nothing. This is not the legacy I plan to leave behind.
An uncomfortable silence fell upon the room. After several long seconds, it was Varensky who broke it.
You choose to see only what you want to see.
Stavropol was beginning to lose his temper. What I see are three lazy pigs who have fed too long at the trough of capitalism, three senile old men who forgot a promise made to their comrades, a promise made to their country.
You do yourself no favors by insulting us, replied Karganov.
Why don't we put it to a vote? Offered Varensky.
A vote?
Stavropol raised an eyebrow. How very democratic. Well, I have to admit I am disappointed, but I am not surprised. We'll put it to a vote, as Comrade Varensky has suggested. But first, let's attend to one other piece of business.
Anything, responded Primovich. Let's just get this over with.
Stavropol smiled. What I want is a full list of the assets we have in place and how to contact them.
Why is that necessary? Demanded Karganov. Since I am the one who started this, I will be the one to finish it. There must be no loose ends.
Surely you don't intend to do away with them? Queried Varensky. These are not mere foot soldiers.
Of course not, Uri, said Stavropol. The assets will simply be recalled to Mother Russia, that's all. That would make all of you happy, wouldn't it?
A dead silence blanketed the table.
And what if they don't wish to be recalled? Asked Primovich.
I'm sure they can be persuaded. Come, we are wasting time. I know there are warm beds waiting for all of you at home. Tell me what I need to know so we can move to a vote.
When all the necessary details had been collected, the other three voted to abandon the operation. It was just as Stavropol had feared. Primovich, Varensky, and even Karganov had gone soft. There was only one option available now.
You can still do great things for Russia. You should take up a hobby, offered General Primovich, coming over to shake his old colleague's hand.
A hobby? Asked Stavropol. That's quite a suggestion. Maybe golf?
Certainly, said Primovich,
a smile forming on his lips as Stavropol picked up the iron poker and pretended to hit a golf ball with it. Stavropol seemed to be taking things better than he expected.
I hear it can be very relaxing.
Primovich's smile quickly disappeared as Stavropol swung the poker full force against the side of his head and cracked open his skull.
Very relaxing, indeed, sneered Stavropol as he let the bloody poker fall from his hands.
What have you done? Screamed Karganov.
You have lost your mind, Varensky shouted as he made an end run around the table for Stavropol.
Stavropol drew a beautifully engraved, black, chrome-plated Tokarev pistol from the small of his back and shot him before he had even made it 3 feet. Karganov couldn't believe what he was seeing. Stavropol was insane. He was sure of it.
So, what will it be, Anatoly? Asked Stavropol. Will you join us? Or will you go the way of Valentin and Uri?
The look on Karganov's face was answer enough.
As you wish, responded Stavropol,
who then fired a single round into Karganov's head.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.